Welcome back, everybody. Let's begin a new chapter of our course. We're going to talk about the one-way repeated measures analysis of variance. I like to see it as a subset of the one-way analysis of variance we already learned. In this video, I'm going to discuss the basic logic of the repeated measures ANOVA. And then, in the next couple of videos, I'm going to do two complete examples from scratch. Let's first discuss when we would use a repeated measures ANOVA. If we're measuring the same people more than twice, that's when we would use a repeated measures ANOVA. We'd use it to see if there are any differences between the treatments we're measuring. Let me give you an example. This graph measures wellness scores. Let's assume that higher scores represent better mental health. In this example, we're dealing with a group of kids who were exposed to something terrible at their school, a mass shooting. When they first presented themselves for therapy, right after the shooting, we'll call that time zero. At that time, their mental health was really struggling. You can see that we then measured those exact same kids 3 weeks into their therapy, 6 weeks into their therapy, 9 weeks, and 12 weeks into their therapy. So we have multiple measures for each kid. In other words, we measured the same people more than twice. That's exactly when we need to use a repeated measures ANOVA. The repeated measures ANOVA that we're going to learn right now is going to tell us if any difference exists. When you look at these wellness scores from week 0 to week 3 to week 6, you can see it looks like there's improvement over time. And that's good news, and our repeated measures analysis of variance would probably find statistically significant differences across the weeks in this situation, because those types of differences are unlikely to occur just by chance. If the repeated measures ANOVA finds differences across those weeks, we could then use Fisher's LSD, otherwise known as protected T, to find specific differences between the weeks. For example, there might be a difference between week 0 and week 3. Week 3 might differ from week 6, but there might not really be a statistically significant difference between week 6, week 9, and week 12. The differences that we see between those last three measurements might be best explained by chance variation. Do you remember when we learned about the one-way analysis of variance? We thought about it as an extension of the independent samples t-test. Well, likewise, you should view the repeated measures analysis of variance as an extension of the related samples t-test. In other words, if we're measuring the same group of people twice, we should do a t-test. But if we're measuring the same group of people two or more times, then we should do the F-test. And remember, the F-test is associated with analysis of variance. In general, all analyses of variance are the same. And you're going to see that this repeated measures one-way ANOVA is just like the one-way ANOVA that we learned previously, with just some minor modifications. With every analysis of variance, we try to assess group differences by partitioning the total variability of our data. So, for example, across all of those students and all of their measurements from week 0 to week 12, we can measure total variability in their wellness scores. But then, of course, we can further analyze that variability, and we can partition out the variability that we see due to the treatments from week 0 through week 12. But remember, we can measure within treatment variability as well. So for example, at week 0, right after that mass shooting, there were differences in the wellness scores of those students. Those overall differences in wellness scores that exist at time 0 would be an example of within treatment variability. That within treatment variability contains subject variability. And that subject variability, to some extent, reflects individual differences between each student. And because we get multiple measures for each student, remember, we measure them at week 0, week 3, week 6, week 9, and at week 12. Because we get multiple measures for each student, we can now measure this subject variability. That's something new for us. Being able to measure those individual differences between the students, being able to measure that subject variability is unique to the repeated measures ANOVA. Once we can assess those individual differences, in other words, once we can account for that subject variability, we can remove that from the within treatment variability, and all that really remains at that point is error variance. Remember, error variance is variance we can't explain. It's variance that we can't systematically measure. It's variability that's due to chance or random error. In the end, after we've removed variability due to individual differences, we're left with a more refined measurement of error variability, and that allows us to achieve a larger F ratio. And that's because our F ratio consists of mean square between treatments over mean square error. In other words, that ratio looks at variability between the treatments. So variability between wellness scores from week 0 all the way to week 12 over variability that we can't explain. With the repeated measures analysis of variance, there is less variability that we can't explain. These are the formulas that we're going to use to compute the repeated measures one-way analysis of variance. Most of those formulas should look familiar. They're the exact same formulas that we used for the one-way ANOVA that we learned previously. Let's change the views and take a look at these formulas just a little bit more closely, and I'll show you exactly what's different with the repeated measures ANOVA. The good news is that with the repeated measures analysis of variance, we're going to use the same basic ANOVA source table. And of course, the goal of analysis of variance is to partition the different sources of variability. So really, it makes most sense to start down here looking at total variability. Those formulas regarding total variability, total sum of squares, and total degrees of freedom are the exact same as the formulas we used previously. Total variability consists of different sources of variability. One source of variability is between treatments variability. That is exactly like the between groups variability we talked about previously. The reason why now I call it between treatments instead of between groups is because we're measuring the exact same people over multiple occasions, multiple treatments. So between treatments as a label just simply fits better. And here's the good news. All of the formulas in that row, all of the formulas associated with the between treatments source of variation are the same formulas we used previously. I just mentioned that total variability consists of between treatment variability, but remember, it also consists of within treatment variability. And here's more good news. The formulas in that row right there, all of the formulas regarding within treatments variability are the same formulas we used previously. So at this point, we've accounted for about 80% of the formulas within that source table, and they're all the same as the formulas we used before. So there's no need to be overwhelmed by the repeated measures analysis of variance. I know you're looking at this source table with all of these formulas, but most of them are the exact same formulas we used before. So the question is, what's different? And what's different is right here. This is new. Remember I mentioned that because we measure the same people on multiple occasions, we can now get a measurement of their individual differences. That's what this source of variability is all about, the subject differences. You can see just by looking at it, the sum of squares formula and the formula for degrees of freedom are pretty straightforward. We're going to be able to walk through that with no problems. Another source of variability that's new on this table is this right here, error variability. And you might recall this error variability is the variability that's left once we remove the variability due to individual differences of the subjects. That makes computing sum of squares error very easy. We'll start with sum of squares within groups, we will subtract sum of squares between subjects, and that will leave us with sum of squares error. It works the same way with degrees of freedom error. We will start with degrees of freedom within groups, we will subtract degrees of freedom between subjects, and that will leave us with degrees of freedom error. Once we know sum of squares error and degrees of freedom error, we can compute mean square error. And then, once we have this measurement of variability we can't explain, and this measurement of variability that we can explain, we can then compute our overall F ratio. And then, like always, we will take that value that we just computed, F obtained, and we will compare it with a critical value, F critical. If that obtained value exceeds our critical value, we have statistically significant results. So overall, that's how we're going to use these formulas to compute our F ratio. Let me show you another example where you can see more easily, see a little bit more clearly how these formulas all work together. As I mentioned, when we do the repeated measures ANOVA, we will use an ANOVA source table that's just like the ANOVA source tables we've used in the past. And in fact, I showed you that some of the sources of variation are computed based on the exact same formulas that we've used previously. So for example, total variability, exactly like we did before. Within treatment variability, exactly like we did before. Between treatment variability, exactly like we did before. So check this out. You're going to see that these numbers work together and make sense, just like they did in the other ANOVA source tables we've worked on previously. Do you remember that we learned that between plus within should equal the total? Well, look at the numbers in this example. Sum of squares between treatments equals 50. Sum of squares within treatments equals 32. 50 plus 32 equals 82. And you can see that sum of squares total equals 82. That makes sense. We can do the same thing with degrees of freedom. Degrees of freedom between treatments equals 3. Degrees of freedom within treatments equals 16. 16 plus 3 equals 19, and you'll see in the table, degrees of freedom total equals 19. As I explained previously, about the only thing that we need to compute new is a new source of variability. Variability due to individual differences between the subjects. This term right here. Using a new formula, we will compute sum of squares between subjects. It'll be easy to use that formula, trust me. Once we find that value, we will subtract that value from sum of squares within treatments. 32 minus 24 equals 8. So it'll be very easy to come up with sum of squares error. It'll work the same way with degrees of freedom. Using a new formula, we'll compute degrees of freedom between subjects. That'll be very easy to do. We'll take that value and we'll subtract it from degrees of freedom within treatments. 16 minus 4 equals 12. So it'll be very easy to compute degrees of freedom error. Once we know sum of squares error and degrees of freedom error, we can simply take 8, divide by 12, and then we get mean square error. Our F ratio then just takes mean square between treatments and divides by mean square error to find this value right here. So just like all ANOVA source tables, the numbers that we see in this ANOVA source table work together logically to help us get to that F ratio. Now that we've talked about the basic logic of the repeated measures analysis of variance, we're ready to compute our first example. And that's what we'll do in the next video. In the meantime, be safe.